God is bigger than that. So God is bigger than any weapon of Satan. Any letter from him, any letter from Satan or our enemies, God is bigger than any hopeless situation. As we are going to see today, I just want to encourage you, I want you to understand that no matter what people are saying, what enemies are planning against you, against your family, against your destiny, against your purpose, God is bigger than that.
Yes.
And I want to go through the scriptures to establish that, to make you to have hope. Hope keeps a man alive. Once someone loses hope, it's very difficult to survive, to break through. So when you keep hope alive, when you continue to trust in the Lord, you will overcome. That might be more Jesus.
Amen.
Any open situation, God is bigger than that. Any situation that can be confusing, confusing circumstances, no matter their population, when anything comes in like that, no matter the population of the enemies, when enemy attempt to strike you, attempt to strike your business, attempt to strike your destiny, attempt to strike your family, the Lord will raise a standard against the enemies.
Amen.
Only if you can trust him. Only if you can trust him. God is bigger than that.
Amen.
Just trust in God. Trust in him. As we're going to see in this message, God is bigger than that part 4. Most of the problems that we have as humans is that we do not totally trust God, we do not totally depend on God. You'll be surprised that even people that go to church, people that say, oh, I'm a Christian, I'm born again, they see go around to voodoo priests, they see go to all these sham places, they see try to do some voodoo. Because they do not trust totally in God. They still believe that they have to do some things to protect themselves. They still have to do some things to have a success, to have breakthrough. They still consult voodoo priest. Just trust in the Lord. The only way the enemy can lose in the battle of your life is when you totally depend on God. But if enemy knows that you are doubting, you know, enemy knows that you are not totally, don't have any confidence in God. If enemy knows that he can easily drink you, then enemy will continue to strike, will continue to come after you, continue to come after you. But when enemy knows that no matter what, you depend on God, you are stable with God, your faith is strong in him, then they are going to be confused. So I want to encourage you, trust in God. Just put your total trust in the Lord. Don't do like those people, they go little bit here, little bit there, little bit there. It's not a very good thing for a serious Christian. I hope you are not one of them. I hope you are not one of them. The other time that we come to the church after we finish fellowship, we still go to go and get some extra shots somewhere. Isaiah 59 verse 19 says, so shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west and his glory from the rising of the sun. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. When enemies come like a flood into your life, into your destiny, listen to me, if you trust God, if you are one of his, the spirit of the Lord that dwells in you will raise a standard against the enemies.
Amen.
The enemy will fail for your cause.
Amen.
Because believe me, totally depend on God. Trust God, totally trust God. Do not mix it together. You see, it's very hard to, I'm telling you, I know our background. I want to be very honest with you. I know our background, the Africans, especially Africans, it's very hard. It's very hard. After one is converted, except if you have a very solid foundation after your conversion and you are exposed to God's word very well and you understand the scriptures, that is where you can stand. And that's why I'm exposing you to the scriptures. You know, Africans, we like to still go do some other things like that. It's only I see the African nations and the African descent that we see some things. I know it's in other races, but it's so common in our race. Look at what is going on in the social media now. People, they will kill human beings for ritual, they will take people go and buy body parts, some will buy their hands, some will buy their chest, some will buy their private part, some will buy their head. I was told that some of those people that are people worship, because our people they worship money. They don't know where they get the faith. But as long as somebody said they will just be worshiping that faith. Oh yes, this is man of God, this is this. They never know what that man of God or what that person or what that politician or what that boss is doing in a secret place. I was told that some people, they don't drink with anything except the skull of human being. That is what they used to drink. Some people all the time, they have to bath all the time with the blood of human beings. Human beings created in the image of God, in the likeness of God. What are they looking for? Temporary power. And that is why the Bible says, seeking first the kingdom of God and the righteousness, and all these things have been added. See, all these things, they do all these things for all these things. It's temporary. It's temporary. Anything that has no eternal value is nothing. Yeah. And anything you do not do in God for the glory of God does not have eternal value. It's all totally waste of time. So I'm just encouraging you. I believe it that those of you that are listening to this message, you don't get involved in things like this.
Amen.
You don't get involved in this like this. Because once, whatever anybody we do, we also live. Nahum chapter 1, the book of Prophet Nahum, chapter 1, number 7 to 9. The Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knows those who trust him. God knows. Look, if you trust God, God knows. If you are a genuine Christian, he knows. If you are double-sided, it will be little bit to this side, little bit to that side. You know, there are people, only when they are coming to this church, they will remove their sharp bandage. The one they put here, they will remove it because they say they don't want Holy Ghost to strike them. And as soon as they are leaving there, they do what? They put it back. I was told that some people, when they walk around, especially, you know what I'm talking about. Life tortoise. They say they carry life tortoise in somewhere. I don't know what is doing for them. Some are looking for protection anywhere. There are some they don't want to die. You know, some people they want to remain. They want to. They do so many nonsense. But God knows those who trust in him. If you are a Christian, you are genuine. That's why God deals with our heart, not you know our facial, all this talk. It deals with the heart of man. He knows if you belong to see. Look at what happened that place. Verse 7. The Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knows those who trust him. But with an overflowing flood, he will make an other end of his place, and that place will pursue his enemies. Amen. Just trust him. Amen. If you trust God, you pitch your tent in God, and somebody wants to be an enemy for you. Somebody wants to pursue you. There's someone wants to create trouble for you. Listen to me. Darkness. We pursue that person.
Amen.
See what I'm speaking? Darkness, we pursue that person. I'm talking of darkness. We pursue that person. You don't need to fight for yourself. You are going to see here as we look at what happened to Judah. Why Ezekiah was the king. We see here, and these things happened for our people like us of this generation. Be honest with God, be down to heart, trust God, believe God. If you don't want to be a Christian, it's better you just leave. Don't go and do what Satan you trust. But to be a little bit here is a big punishment, it's suffering. If you are not hard, you are not cold, you are just, God does not want, stand. If you want to be a Christian, be a Christian. If you want to be over there, be over there. When we lose, a fool or a loser runs in all directions. A loser runs in all directions. Then wait. Just pick one and stay there. And pitch your tent there. And see the result. When I pray, you will pick God in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. You will trust God in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Because blessed are those that trust in his name. Verse 9. What do you conspire against the Lord? What? He will make an other end of it. Affliction will not rise up a second time. No. Now, if you are a Christian, you are born again, you pitch your tent in the Lord. Listen, affliction will not rise second time. Before you give your life to Jesus Christ, there are a lot of afflictions to pass through.
Now you are a Christian, affliction will not rise the second time in your life. You will face challenges. The Lord knows everything. He knows your breaking point. He knows what you can do. He knows how much you can go. He knows when you can break down and melt. Affliction will never rise the second time if you can trust in the Lord.
Amen.
And whatever you may be passing through, whatever is facing you, affliction will not rise the second time.
Amen.
Those that have run into this nation for refuge, listen to me very carefully. The Lord will deliver them. Forces are saying, let it be affliction again. You are running from a hard place, and they say, we will make it harder for you. But I tell you the truth, based on God's word, affliction will not rise the second time. And God will make everything beautiful in His own time. Trust me. He will make everything beautiful in His own time because God is greater than that. He's greater than anything we may face. He's greater than any mountain that may face us. Because who are thou who said this mountain before Zerubbabel? You will be made plain. It's never by power, it's not by might, it's by the Spirit of God. I am telling you, please totally trust in the Lord. I'm not taking it for granted. Totally trust in the Lord because there are people that live double life. Even among ministers, among the people, the so-called pastors, they live double life. And I tell you the truth, you have to know what I'm saying. If you decide and you don't invade it, see, the earlier we understand it, the better our life will be. The earlier we begin to live an honest life and be honest with the Lord, the better your life, the better you enjoy the peace that God has prepared for you. The better you have the rest that is apportioned for the people of God. Otherwise, it's going to be hard to make headway.
I love to read this book, Job chapter 22. I will just read two verses and then maybe we'll go straight to the story I want to use as example today. Are you with me today?
Yes.
I just want to be down around with us. There are a lot of rat race going on in the world today. A lot of rat race. There are people, I will tell you what is going on. There are people that with all the effort they make, with all the suffering, and then the people get into this country from many parts of the world. Maybe from the Caribbean side, maybe from Africa, from this, and then they get back to this place with all the pursuing and pursuing. Do you know that even after they have arrived here, they still continue the pursuit. They still continue the lifestyle. They still continue to. They don't have peace. They don't have rest. They still think that they still have to continue the lifestyle. It's not only people from Africa. I was told that I was talking to a friend of mine. I said, oh, I want to a white friend of mine, a Caucasian. I said, I'm thinking, and my wife and I were thinking of going to Jamaica. I said, don't go to Jamaica. It's a voodoo place. This is a white man that was telling me that. I guess if his friend should tell him that they go to Africa, he's going to tell them, don't tell them to go to Africa. It's a voodoo place. I think because if they say Jamaica is a good place, I tell them the truth, Africa is a super mother of voodoo. Or I will be very honest with you, mother of voodoo. I mean, you see somebody in Africa who does not believe in voodoo, except you are totally delivered. Honestly speaking, let me be very down to earth. My dad was a civil servant. And at the same time, a part-time herbalist. He was a civil servant, but a part-time herbalist. He does all this oracle, he loves doing all this oracle. And my father, he still goes to church. He will go to African church. He will take us to church. But when he comes back home, he will still practice all these things because they believe they can still be doing that thing. Let me tell you the surprising thing to you. Do you know that people in IPAC, my father just had standard 6, educated people, principals of schools, people that are in the church, in the, I won't mention the name of churches, but educated people, they will come in the night to consult my daddy. Hello?
Hi.
Who are very young, they will be looking at them. They will come in the night. People with degrees. My father is just standard 6. People with degree, principals of school, they will come. My father never bought a car. The best I've seen my father bought was a bicycle. These people will drive their cars, they will drive it in front of the house. They come in the night, mostly in the night, and they will go inside. My father will prepare everything for them. they are oracle, they will take the oracle, they will take title, they will prostrate, they will take the oracle to their place. When they go to the school in the morning and they are principal of schools, what do you think those kind of principals will be telling students? What do you think will be telling students? Now, what I'm trying to tell you is that all these beliefs that we are carrying around can help us. It's either we trust in God or we throw those things away. They that trust in the Lord, they are like Mount Zion. As mountains surround Jerusalem, the Lord will surround his own people.
Amen.
If you don't trust God, if you trust in all those dead, little gods, you are playing fool. Are you with me today?
Yes, sir.
You are playing fool. I don't know if I'm talking to somebody here today. I don't know if I'm talking to somebody here today. If you are retired, you live double life, maybe after you live here, you still go and get that sham they gave you. You are deceiving yourself.
Absolutely.
You are what?
Deceiving yourself.
That's your prayer you are praying. Didn't pass this city. You are deceiving yourself. If you want to be one, be one. Want to be two, be two. If you want to serve God, serve God. If you want to serve God, drop it. It's so terrible to see what people are doing. The so-called Christians. Some if they are going to eat, they still going to put some things in their food, they will bring to them. Some, when they cook, they will say, this is water, this is green water. They will put it here. So people that are serving food for people to eat, when they cook that food, they will go and put something inside. I'm telling you something serious that people are doing. And they said, are people see they brought this kind of thing into this country, they brought it to this country. Water, okay. Okay, I understand people that are coming over there. They want to have, because there are too much of competition. They want money. This is a place of, if you work here, you live a decent life.
Absolutely.
You eat, what good? Is it not for eat? Why do we go around doing all this nonsense? Why do you have to believe in all this? How much do you think you need? I want to ask you today. Do you know that in most part of the world, people live below $1 per day.
Mm-hmm.
Below $1. And some of us, we are here now, in this country. Nobody here in this country that will not live more than $1. Mm-hmm. If you don't have any money, you just want to McDonald's, you stand there and say, I need a cup of coffee. Can somebody give me a cup of coffee here, please? Can somebody please give me a cup of coffee here, please? Before you know it, men will say, I'm going to pay. Do you need the establishment to go? Do you need a little bit of brandy? Some people will pay, they will pay for you. And then you have, it's not your money, right? But if it's that only one coffee you have taken today, you have lived more than $1 per day.
Absolutely.
But then our people still come in here. They see to all this corner cut here. For what reason? You ask yourself one day, for what? For what? For what? And most of these things will take peace away from people.
Right.
Because what goes around will come around. Anything you do in a wrong way will be paid back to you.
Absolutely.
And that's why being good to people. Don't rob Peter to pay Paul. Don't destroy somebody's destiny to build your own destiny. Don't put down somebody's house and take the bricks from the house you have put down to go and build your own house. You are wasting time. It's not going to stand.
Absolutely.
It's not what? It's not going to stand. It's not going to stand. And especially when we say we are Christian, and then we pray together. God is greater than that. No matter what you are facing, trust God. He will see you through. Do you understand me now? Put your total trust in God. Let's look at the case of King Hezekiah. King Hezekiah, when he was ready, the Bible recorded that at a point in time in his ready, look at Acts 36. Now it came to pass in the 14th year of King Hezekiah, 14th year of his reign, in Jerusalem, that Sennacherib, king of Assyria, came up against all the 45 cities of Judah and took them. The city was fortified. The city was reinforced. So the enemies, you see, the issue of enemies has been for a long time. And you see, one of the reasons why people run around, they do this, some people deceive them, hey, either you have money, you don't have money, you are educated, you are not educated, you are a Christian, you are not a Christian, you are black, you are blue, you are red, you are pink, you are white, you go to have enemies. Do you understand now?
Oh, yes.
Either it's a rich nation, is a poor nation, you're going to have enemies. Do you know that those Sahara countries, they have enemies? Those countries where they are for poor, but they have enemies. Either you are English, you are this, you will have. So these people, they were blessed by God. They were blessed by God. The Jews were blessed by God. You see what just happened recently? How can somebody walk into a synagogue where people are? You give people in assembly. Why? Give people up into something else. Old. Why? See, you see the level of hatred? So those of you that are blessed, because of the grace of God in your life, people will hate you.
That's right.
People will be jealous at you. People will envy you.
You are right.
Be very happy when people jealous you. Be what? When they envy you, be what? Be happy when people envy you. You understand me now? And then stay with God.
Amen.
You cannot control that. You cannot control what people can do against you. You can control your response to those people. And that's what we're going to see today. So the king of Zennacherus, this king has been very known for military invasion. They've taken over so many countries, so many cities. So if they came to Judah to take over Judah. And look at the message, go to verse 4. The message of the king said, then the Rashi said to them, send a messenger. After surrounding the city, he sent a messenger into the city and said, say now to Hezekiah, thus says the great king, the king of Assyria, what confidence is this in which you trust? You see, anything can come to you and look at you, and you are so happy. I can see you and your wife, you are happy, you are chanting. What confidence do you have? What kind of trust? You are asking you, okay. What do you trust in this? Can this deliver you? You are not doing what we are doing. You are not reversing yourself. You do not have this, you don't have that. No sham, no voodoo. What do you trust in? So the messenger to Ezekiah told these people, what confidence is this in which you trust? I said you speak of having plans and power for war, but they are mere walls. Now in whom do you trust that you rebel against me? So the king was telling Ezekiah, send a messenger to tell Ezekiah. You can read that continuously, but look at verse 11. So the messenger begin to speak. Sometimes devil will continue to speak, to create fear into you, to make you to doubt what you trust in, to make you to get discouraged, not to continue. So I don't know those that the enemies have created fear in them right now, and they don't feel like continuing in life. They don't feel like continuing in this place. They don't feel like moving on. I told you those weapons. Those are the weapons of Satan to create fear, to create doubt, to create discomfort, to make you get discouraged. These are the weapons. As we are feeling this, as we are feeling that, just know that it's devil, and don't give in to devil.
Amen.
Verse 11. Then Eliakim, Shema, and Joa said to the Rabeshkar, the messenger, please speak to your servant in Aramaic. Speak to us in Aramaic so that the Hebrews will not know what you are telling us, so we can take care of ourselves. But we understand it. And do not speak to us in Hebrew, in the midst of the people who are on the wall. But the messenger refused. He said, as my master sent me to your master and to you to speak this word, and not to the men who sit on the wall, who will eat and drink their own ways with you. So all your military sitting on the wall trying to protect the city, I don't want to speak a language they know that they will understand. I want to speak to the king, Ezekiah, in Hebrew, so for you to know that this is not a joke. My master is coming to take over this city. Sennacherib. So the messenger began to speak in Hebrew. And look at what really touched my heart. And most times devil speak like this. Try to challenge your faith. Try to challenge your relationship with Christ. Try to challenge your Christianity. You must understand when enemies are trying to challenge your Christianity, are trying to challenge the trust you have in the Lord, are trying to challenge your position. You must understand and give a right approach to it. And you're going to see the approach of King Ezekiah here. Are you all with me today?
Yes, sir.
And this is a Bible story that I want you to take your time to read and see how people can overcome as a Christian. And if you can approach the issue of your life like this way, you will be successful.
Amen.
Victory will be sure.
Amen.
In any aspect Shaphan stood and called out with a loud voice in Hebrew. This was the messenger from King Sennacherib. You understand now? He came in and he was speaking in a loud voice in Hebrew. Hear the voice of the great king, the king of Assyria. God says the king, do not let Hezekiah deceive you, for he will not be able to deliver you. Tell the people now. Tell them surrender. If you surrender, the king Sennacherib will give you everything you want. Good food, good everything. Surrender. Don't listen to your king. So let me tell you that. To trust something else. Don't listen to your husband. It's not going to help you. Surrender to us. We're going to take care of you. Don't listen to your father. Don't listen to your parents. They can't do anything to you. Surrender to us. There is nobody who can be your father like your father can be. There's nobody who can be your mother like your mother can be. There's nobody who can be who can really love you like God can love you. So this is a big deceit. If the Jews would have listened to Sennacherib and they've been taken to captivity, they cannot be loved like God can love them in their own place. And that's why when they were taken to captivity and coming back, when they were singing, how can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? No matter how good foreign land is, it cannot be like home. Amen?
Amen.
So, verse 15. Now let Hezekiah make you trust in the Lord. Somebody tell you, don't let somebody make you trust in the Lord. That is an insult to God. If we don't trust in God, who else can we trust? If we don't depend on God, who else can we depend on? Say the Lord will surely deliver us. The city will not be given into the hands of the king of Assyria. Say, don't listen to Hezekiah. Say that. Sometimes when we speak positive words, they may look like too sweet to be believed. But you as a Christian, you must speak word that can increase your faith, word that can encourage you. You must not at any time speak word that is negative, even when the situation in your life is negative. You must always speak word of encouragement. Here the enemies was telling the people, don't listen to all this word of encouragement that Hezekiah was saying. No one can be back from this great king Sennacherib. Say, don't listen to him. Say, make peace, verse 16. Do not listen to Hezekiah, for thus says the king of Assyria, make peace with me by a present and come out to me, and every one of you eat from his own vine, and everyone from his own fig tree, and every one of you drink the waters of his own cistern, until I come and take you away to a land like your own land, a land of grain and new wine, a land of bread and vineyard. Beware lest Hezekiah persuade you, saying that God will deliver us, as any of these gods of nations delivered his land from the hand of the king of Assyria. You cannot compare those dead gods to the living God. No, they are incomparable. That's what I'm telling you. This is the truth. You cannot compare, no matter how powerful the voodoo is. Now, I'm not saying to you, believe me honestly speaking. I was telling you about my dad. It's good for you to use certain things that you have seen, okay, to talk to people. Then you know that person is down to earth. I want to thank God I'm a Christian, I'm born again. I am a Christian, I am born again. I do not miss anything to it. If I'm not totally born again, and you meet me, I will put you. I'm serious. I have seen it done. I'm born again. Look, I'm born again. I'm done to earth. You come in here, enjoy Christ, go home. There's peace for you. There are places you go, they love you blind. You will do some things that they will control, they will psyche you. We have some psychic priests now, they call themselves, they say spiritual. Go and do spiritual psychist. The psychic people, they say they are Christian psychic. It is not true. There's nothing like that. Darkness is always darkness. Darkness are like, when they mean, life overcome darkness. I'm not telling you, this is how you listen with me now. I'm not telling you that there's no power in voodoo. There's power in it. Okay? Because the power given to Satan was not taken from Satan. He has been judged, but he still carried around. But you cannot compare the power of Satan to the power of God. You cannot compare the little God's power to the power of the living God. The power of the living God is not comparable. It's not. The power of Satan can cease. The power of Satan can fail. The power of God can never fail.
Yes.
I've seen my dad do it. People will come, snake will bite them. They will come, they will bring them to my dad. They will bring them to my dad. dad said, my dad, you know, my dad has one kind of confidence. He's never afraid. He tells them, we speak this Igbo language. Everywhere, and this he will just take the razor blade in his hand. He will be talking, just talking. And then the poison, the snake poison, I've seen it done, I'm not telling you what I read. The snake poison in that leg will continue to come out. Then we take a little knife, what again, continue to come out. After a while, we tell them, just dress it and go. That is it. Are you understand? You understand me now?
Yes, sir.
Just speaking. That is it. But see, that power, see, there are 40 angels. All the power given to them is with them. But they have limitations. You cannot compare their power to the power of God. That's what I'm saying here. The message I was telling them, you remember what King Sennacherib did to all other nations around with their gods? You are comparing those little nations around with the living God who will say and bring to pass, who will speak and do it, will stand by his word. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God is constant, my brother.
Yes.
God is faithful, my brother. Anyone that put his trust in you will never be put to shame.
Yes.
Storm can come, flood can come, anything can come, but if you stand in the Lord will stand with you.
Amen.
But the problem is, this weapon, don't doubt the power of God. Do not doubt the extent God can go in your situation. Because it's going to be everything beautiful in his time. Do not doubt what God can do when people think that it's no more possible. The Lord will say, it is when people are saying that, no more way. The God will say, I am the way.
Yes.
I am the truth. I am the life. I'm telling you what I know, my brother. God is greater than that.
Yes.
The power of God is what?
Greater
than that. I want to say, Father, I thank you for this pastor. I thank you, Lord, for this pastor.
I thank you for my pastor.
If you see what people are doing, I'm serious with you. If you see what people are doing over there,
it's true.
Look. If you see what people are doing over there, it will blow your mind. See, I'm not telling you. Right now, I don't fear. There's nothing anything can do to me. I don't care because I know the power there is limited. I know that the power there is not the power that I have experienced, this power of God. Prayer works. That instances I will just pray and God will do it. Instances I will just call on God and God will answer. Prayer works.
Yes.
But it's the other time, they will give you rules, they will give you regulations. If you miss the rules, I'm telling you, it will fail.
So let us move inside.
So after all the noise they made, do you know the approach of Hezekiah the king? What did he tell people? He passed a kind of ordinance. Look at verse 21. He passed a commandment. But they held their peace and answered him not a word. For the king's commandment was, do not answer him. Sometimes in our life, we need to be quiet sometimes. When the enemy comes and is making noise, don't speak back to the enemies. Because if you think that the two of you, you are the same. Sometimes you just have to be like, keep your cool. Tell somebody, keep your cool.
Keep your cool.
Everyone wants to run around. I say, oh, I'm confused. I don't know what to say. But if you don't know what else to do, go and sleep. Amen?
Amen.
Keep your cool. King Hezekiah did what? King Hezekiah kept his cool. And he told the people, keep your cool. And you must learn to listen to your leaders. Amen?
Amen.
Children, you must learn to listen to your parents, especially when they are godly parents. The king passed this commandment, and the people followed him. They did the same thing. They kept his messenger was making noise. We're going to take all of you. We're going to kill all of you. There are other nations. There is no nation. enemies is to just keep quiet. To just keep quiet. Somebody is at you, shouting. Hey you! Hey! Look at how short you are! You are shorter than the girl. You this fool! Look at how look at your mouth! Look at this! Look at that! You are just looking. He's calling you all names. Look at how tall you are! You are too tall! Look at how fat you are! You are too fat! Look at you are even talking! Look at your mouth! You didn't even wash your mouth! Your mouth is smelly! He's telling you all this thing! He's meant to press your body. Now what are you doing? Instead of talking, what are you doing? You get quiet. You are looking. After I do it, can't you talk? You don't want to talk. You just get quiet. You are just looking. It's one of the greatest weapons you can use against somebody. Because you don't know what is going on in your mind. You don't know what is going to happen. You don't know what is going to be your reaction. You just get quiet. This was the practice of the kings. But then, if you go further, why? I put something down here. Why did the king say people should not talk? People should keep quiet. The first reason is this. Any battle of our life, if we are born again, we are Christian, it's not our battle.
Yes.
Any battle of your life is God's battle.
Amen.
If you are on the wall, if you are on the Lord's side, any battle of your life is not your battle. It's the Lord's battle. But somebody is talking to you, somebody is trying to reproach you, that person is not trying to reproach you, he's trying to reproach the God that you are serving. And listen, when the battle is not your battle, it's God's battle, you will win.
Amen.
I'm saying it, you'll be victorious.
Amen.
When the battle is not your battle and you allow God to fight that battle for you, you will come out rejoicing.
Amen.
You will come out shouting for joy.
Amen.
Read the scripture in 2 Chronicles 16:9. 2 Chronicles 16:9. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those who are his loyal to him. If your heart is loyal to God, if your heart is stable on God, the Lord will show himself strong on you in your battle.
Amen.
I am serious about this. Make your heart loyal to God. Be honest when you are dealing with God. Don't play hide and seek with God. If you do that and you call on the Lord, at any point of your life, the Lord will fight your battle for you.
Amen.
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 He will fight your battle for you.
Amen.
He will see you through this journey. Look at 2 Timothy 2. I think it's 2 Timothy. Timothy. I don't know if it's 2 or 1st. But it's verse 19 to 20. Again, listen here. Nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands. Having this say, the Lord knows those who are his. And let everyone who names the name of the Lord of Christ depart from iniquity. The Lord knows those who are his. The Lord knows those who are serving him. Enemies when they come. So, look at what Ezekiel. Let's jump quickly to what Ezekiel did because of our time. So, Ezekiel took all these messages that he had from all this noise. You know, he told people to be quiet, not to talk. But then, this commandment he gave to people is not a commandment without action. It's a commandment with action. When I'm telling you, keep quiet, sometimes you keep quiet against the enemies. Don't utter a word against the enemies. You know where the strength of the battle is. Then you go to the source of that strength. That was in Ezekiel did. Chapter 37 of that Isaiah. And so it was when King Ezekiel had it that he tore his clothes, covered himself with sackcloth, and went into the house of the Lord. Where did he go?
House of the Lord.
When you are faced with challenges of life, when you are faced with storm in life, where do you go?
House of the Lord.
This is what I'm saying about our people. Where do you, who do you call?
God.
Some of us, any small thing, you take your phone call for somebody who even who doesn't even know how to resolve the problem of his own life. That's what you do. Some of us, instead of us to call, you can yourself come to the house of God. You can yourself bring your situation to God. Anyone that calls on the name of the Lord, the same shall be what?
Saved.
You can call the pastor to pray with you, but you also yourself. God, see to this my situation.
Amen.
And you are saying it in your heart. You think God is not listening to you? Is it God is not hearing you? He's hearing you if you speak to him.
Oh, yes.
He hears. He's present. He's an unseen guest in anywhere his people gather together. Say, so where two or three people shall gather together in my name, I will what? I will be there. God is in this place.
Amen.
My sister. God is in this place.
Amen.
My brother, God is here with us.
Amen.
His name is Emmanuel, God with us.
Amen.
Ezekiah took the letter to the house of God. And then they really got themselves together to meet with God. They got their prophet Amos, look at verse 3, and they said to him, thus says Ezekiah, talking to the prophet. This day is a day of trouble and a rebuke and a blasphemy. For the children have come to bow, but there is no strength to bring them forth. Do you know that kind of situation? I said that happened to you. I want to ask our mothers. Ask our mothers. You are in labor. You are in labor. And the baby is about to come out, but there is no strength to bring out the baby. It's one of the most dangerous times for any mother. And doctors are here. You don't ask them. A woman is trying to give birth. The baby is ready. The baby is engaged. It's ready to come out. But there's no sweat. Doctor is saying, push! She's doing like this. Push! Will the doctor push for him, for her? Maybe the next thing doctor we have to do is to, you know, either this is a section, or if the doctor can grab the head, you know, cause some tears, which may not be very easy. So they were in this situation. The children were ready to come out, but they lacked the strength to deliver. That is this serious situation in the life of the Israelite. This is a situation. Now, look at New English translation. Look at how they are now working. That one says, this is what Isaiah said. This is a day of distress, insult and humiliation, as when a baby is ready to leave the birth canal. The birth canal, but the mother lacks the strength to push it through. That was the story they find themselves. Job 22 verse 29. When men are cast down, then thou shalt say, there is a lifting up, and it shall save the humble person. When people are cast down in this situation, in this life, I pray to the Almighty God, you will say there is a lifting up.
Yeah.
When people are in this kind of situation and there is no strength to carry through, you will say the strength of the Lord is, the job of the Lord is my strength.
Amen.
When you are in a situation when it seems as if it is good at the help of people, you want to give up, you will say, I will not give up. There will be a lift up, there will be a promotion, there will be a success.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
You will not give up.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus. God is bigger than that. So verse 5 says, so the servant of King Ezekiah came to Isaiah and to them, thus you shall say to your master, thus say the Lord, do not be afraid of the words which you have heard, with which the servant of the king of Assyria have blasphemed me. Surely I will send a spirit upon him, and he shall hear a rumor, and return to his own land, and I will cause him to fall by the sword in his own land. That was the end of the story. In fact, one thing I read, that this king was killed by his own, one of his sons. When enemies are shouting on you and shouting on that, trying to make you afraid, it may be powerful. Listen, it is possible. I'm not doubting it. It is possible that that enemy is very powerful. You understand now? It is possible that that person has done havoc in the life of some other people. But that does not mean that he can do the repeat of the same with you.
That's right.
No. It is possible that that person is so wicked, he has killed so many people. But that does not mean that he can kill you. No. You have to choose where you stand. You have to say, this is it. You can't pass this stage. You have to say, power of God. Stand in this trust we have in God. I want to continue to build your trust in the Lord. Do not be afraid. There's nothing anybody can do to you. This message is coming to you to tell you to keep hope alive.
Amen.
Keep hope alive. Anything will come like a flood. There is nothing you can do about that. If God is blessing you, the more God will bless you, the more enemies you're going to have. Do you understand now? The more you are blessed, the more enemies you will have. Sometimes they will come to stop you, but this to be very carefully. When they come like a flood, the spirit of the living God will raise a standard against the enemies for your sake. Only do something with me. Trust the Lord totally. You know, I'm telling you, if I'm feeling this way, God is even feeling more. I don't like when people do it will be there, it will be there. I don't like. It's better to fall into the hands of God. Listen to me. It's better for me to do what? To fall. I am not going to try any other power. I'm telling you this. Listen. Determine in your heart that you will stay with the Lord. That if God is every day cutting you, like God will say, every day slicing you, what will you do? You will trust in Him. You will make your way perfect before Him. You do your own part and wait and see what God is going to do in your life.
Amen.
You try that. Trust God totally. Don't mix it with anything. If you face any trouble, speak to Him. If you face any challenge, call Him. He doesn't sleep. Most of these gods, they sleep. Hello?
Hi.
Most of these power, they get tired. Most of these power, sometimes they get weak. Sometimes they get confused. Sometimes they don't even know what to do. Don't you know that as powerful, as knowledgeable doctors are, doctors, they also seek treatment.
Absolutely.
Excuse me.
Hi.
Are you here with me?
Yes, sir.
They do what?
Seek treatment.
They seek treatment. We have some guru here, nurses. They are good. Right? They've been doing nursing for years. Don't they go to hospital also?
Yes.
Hello?
Hi.
Okay, let's look at pharmacies. Pharmacies there. We got some of them. They know all medications. They even know all the side effects of medications. But when it is time for them to take it, won't they take it?
They will take it, yes.
Will they say, will they say that?
No.
But do you know the difference? Do you know the difference? With that of God, God doesn't take all these things.
Exactly.
God doesn't take any other power.
Exactly.
He can exist without you.
Exactly.
He's all knowing, all everything, all. That is why we have to trust Him and nothing else.
Oh, yes.
You totally depend on Him and nothing else. You know, sometimes I look into the field of engineering and I look at how much knowledge God has given to engineers. Sometimes we design, being a civil engineer, sometimes we look at the way we put some steel together, we put this thing, you cross this thing, because we just follow the book. And when you construct it like that, the house will stand. The house will stand. Some will stand for years. And sometimes I'll be asking myself, we just follow what is in this book. And we build this house, and this house is still standing. Years, what will happen? But when we just make a little mistake, you fail to do what he asks you to do. When he asks you to go to collapse, the collapse will be so great. They were constructing a bridge or somewhere, I think Miami, Florida. And they made a mistake. When the bridge collapsed, kill people, kill motorists. Just a little mistake. Can you imagine if God should have made a mistake about the position of sun, position of moon, position of stars, position of this, even this place we are in? You do not imagine if God should have made a mistake. We are what? We are gone. But God does not make mistakes. That is why you have to trust. That's why it's bigger than that.
Amen.
God knows everything. He knows the beginning of your life. He knows the end of your life. Will you please trust Him?
Oh, yes.
Put your total trust in Him. Do not trust in anything else. No matter what, He will see you through this journey. Amen. take this road, Lord? Why did I take this road? I was reading somebody from Rotary Club traveled to Port Harcourt in Lagos and was talking to people about security. And he put some things down. People say, they would say, oh, this is a good information. The man was telling them to secure yourself, make sure when you come out in the morning, don't take the same road you take every day. The man said, if you take this road today, when you are going out tomorrow, take another road. The man was giving them all the scenarios to escape people that are planning against them. And he gave all this information to the people outside. And something that we say, when you release this information to everybody will do the same thing. And at the end of the day, it's no longer secret. For God is not like that. God is not like that. When God is going to secure you, even when you make a mistake in wherever you take, He will do what? He will secure you. Even when you are sleeping, you don't know how to take care of it, God is taking care of it for you.
Amen.
God is greater than that. Tell somebody God is greater than that. Tell somebody, please trust in His name. About the issue of your life, please trust God. About the health, your health, trust God. About your finances, trust God. About your family, trust God. About your papers, whatever, trust God. About your education, trust God. About the love of your life, trust God. About your ministry, trust God. When you trust God, testimonies must follow. They will never be put to shame.